Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
The bulk of the Flames preseason is over, and we still have no Johnny Gaudreau signing. But let's wrap up what we do have and who's still left at camp. I'm Dan, as always. I'm here with Matt. Matt, it's been a busy week with five games. How are you feeling looking at the team overall right now?
Well, the Flames have some good things going about the team and some things that they need to improve upon. And some of the things that they need to improve upon, they won't be able to address right away. But overall, it's been a positive experience, especially seeing the goaltenders playing as well as they have.
Well, let's break it down. Let's go game by game for those that didn't watch. I know that a lot of people haven't been watching all the preseason games. So the Flames opened the preseason with a back-to-back split squad game. And the first game we'll talk about is the home game, where the Oilers sent players to Calgary to play the Calgary Flames, and the Oilers won 2-1 in this game. It was 1-1 for a long time, and the Oilers got an empty netter at the end. But Matt, if you take a look at the roster, you and I were there for this game. Take a look at the roster the Flames put out there. They had a pretty good-looking roster. I mean, Stajan, Tkachuk, Brouwer, Shinkarik, Joki Paka, Giordano, Weidman, Brody. Not what we're expecting as a typical, I guess, preseason roster. I was expecting a lot more young guys, but maybe it's because it was a split squad. We saw Elliott and Nett. When you looked at this roster up front, were you thinking that they should have been able to do more damage to the Oilers?
Well, not really. You got to figure that the Flames realistically only had their second line out there for, like, if you're looking at the team in the regular season. So the fact that they only managed the one goal late in the game, it's not really a surprise. Like, this team is adapting to a new system, and they didn't have a ton of offensive talent in the lineup.
But, I mean, neither did Edmonton. They sent a couple, you know, they sent Yakupov, they sent Cassian, Pat Maroon. That's really the end of their offensive talent. But, you know, their goalies were Brassois and Gustafsson. Neither one's a good goalie. I was kind of expecting Tkachuk and Brouwer to have lit it up more than they did.
Yeah, and if you look at the goal that Edmonton scored with the goalie in the net, it was a shot from behind the net that hit Mason McDonald in the shoulder and bounced in. And the empty net goal, of course, came after, and then the Flames scored to break the shutout. So, overall, yeah, they could have done better offensively, but it's the first game of the preseason, and guys like Bennett and Tkachuk and Brouwer were all trying to find their chemistry together.
And you could see the rust. I mean, if you looked, you and I were watching it, you could see that these guys were rusty. They weren't in top form yet, and that's why we have preseason.
For sure, and it's always frustrating to see the team not perform well, but I've been to enough preseason games over the last 10 years, and that's pretty much what you get every year for the first, like, five or six games.
Overall, I thought that the Flames played well. I mean, especially considering the Oilers roster that's put out there. We had 33 shots on goal to the Oilers' 21. We were much more disciplined. We only had 15 penalty minutes to the Oilers' 32. And I don't know about you, but we really saw in kind of the second half of this game, Tkachuk really coming alive with sort of the gritty play that he's known for. The first half of the game, it looked like he wasn't really sure how he should play. And then at the second half, about the 11-minute mark in the second, I think we really started to see him mixing it up. We really started to see him getting involved in some, you know, scrums behind the net, just really kind of going at it his way and playing his game.
Yeah, I can't argue with that. I think he's done enough between all of the games that he's appeared in that he's earned himself at least the 9-game tryout.
You and I were also saying in this first game, when Edmonton came to Calgary, that we could really see a new system in place. It seemed like the team, you were mentioning when we were watching that there was less room between the forwards and defense in the Calgary zone. I was noticing that everyone just seemed to know where they were going. So in the preseason especially, we have these guys sort of playing different ways, but every line seemed to know exactly what they're supposed to do. They all seem to understand what they were doing, so it looks like the Gulletin system is already in full force.
Yeah, and especially it became noticeable on things like the penalty kill that the players were collapsing more and more willing to allow shots from the outside or the point. And if you've got like four or five bodies right in front of the net, you're going to absorb any rebounds most of the time. So it's giving up low percentage shots and allowing the rest of the team to either get the puck or allow the goalie to see it and stop it.
Yeah, I was quite happy. I mean, yeah, we lost the game. It doesn't count for anything, but I was quite happy overall, I think, with how the Flames played. I think everybody was doing their part in this game, and you know what? It just didn't go our way. And it was good to see the new system come in. The same night, the Flames were also in Edmonton playing the other half of the split squad game, for which they lost 4-2 to the Oilers. And this was, I think, a more interesting roster to me, just because it was a mix of part-time tryout guys who are NHL veterans. Like, we had Higgins, Koprakowski in there. We had Nick Grossman playing, and a bunch of young Flames players. Brett Pollock, Garnet Hathaway, Mark Jankowski, Mangiapane, Gillies, Johnson. So I thought that this was the more interesting of the two rosters. And again, they just didn't get it done.
And again, it's preseason. I'm not going to hold anybody too accountable for any of that.
No, and I mean, this is where you're trying things out. New lines, new ways of playing. So we can't, you know, we can't hold the team too accountable for any of that. But it was interesting to see the way that some of these guys played. I didn't watch the game live because you and I were at the Calgary game, but watching it afterwards, I thought that Higgins looked especially good of this team, and I was a little bit disappointed by Poirier, and we'll talk later. That's probably why he got cut, but also Jankowski I really thought emerged. I mean, Janko got one assist on the game, but I really thought that Janko and Freddie Hamilton were looking really good in that game, especially for young players.
Yeah, I can't argue with that.
It's interesting, Matt. I don't know if you've been to the... There's a lot of people talking about the new Flame site and the new way that they're doing stats on the NHL site. If you look at the scratches for these games on NHL.com, there's players listed as scratches that don't play for us or haven't played for us in years. They have Andre Medvedev listed as a scratch, Yuri Turbachev, Ruslan Zanyulin, Andre Tarutukin. Like, where are they getting these stats from? Those guys haven't been Flames in years.
Well, maybe they're eventually coming over.
But I don't even think we have their rights anymore.
No.
Like, Tarutukin's got to be in his late 20s by now. It also lists Linus Lindstrom. So, you know, some odd stats that NHL.com is using. I expect more from NHL.com.
Yeah, Tarutukin's 33.
There you go. So he's not coming over anytime soon.
No.
But yeah, I was just looking at this, like, you know, some of these names, like, where are you guys getting this from? You know, Rafikov hasn't been around here in a long time. Trubachev's got to be about the same age. So just really weird to see that when I was looking through the scratches. I'm like, why would these guys still be listed? I could see some third-party fan site or something, but NHL.com, that really surprised me.
Yeah. Well, it's a new system for them, so they've got to iron out...
Yeah, but they've been keeping stats for years. I know, is what they do.
But they got to iron out the kinks, and obviously that was one of the things that they messed up, so I don't expect that kind of thing to last for very long.
Hopefully not when they get back to the actual season. So the next night, on the 27th of September, the Calgary Flames took a road trip to Winnipeg. They essentially played the same roster they played in Edmonton with a couple minor changes, and the Flames ended up winning 3-0. Matt, do you want to start with some of your thoughts on this game?
Chad Johnson was awesome. Period.
He looked like a veteran NHL goalie. This is the game that, for me, got me excited about Johnson as a goalie. You know, we knew that he was supposed to be the backup, and I don't think there's any contesting that. But, yeah, he looked really good in this game. I was really excited, and I was really excited to see him play his next game after this.
Yeah, he made a couple of dynamite saves in the second period, and the entire time he was in the net, he was quite impressive. So that is a large departure from last season's goaltending performances. Like, I felt more comfortable with even Johnson and net than any of the goaltenders we had last year. So that'll be an encouraging thing to look forward to as we go along into the regular season.
Freddie Hamilton got a goal again in this game. You and I got a chance to see him later in the week. I'm really liking the development of Freddie Hamilton this year. Last year, I thought he was sort of a bubble AHL guy, but he's really come along.
Yeah, he, I think, would not be out of place as the fourth line center this year. He kind of brings some physicality. Like, if you imagine, like, the fourth line being a pairing of Ferland, Hamilton, and Hathaway, like, that's a rather fast, physical, in-your-face type of line. So, I would expect him to make the NHL roster this year, and he seems like a decent NHL-caliber player.
Yeah, I mean, when we got him, you and I kind of talked about how, oh, we're just bringing him in because his brother's here and he'll probably never play. But he's really turned things around, and I think that's awesome for Freddie. I like his game. I like watching Freddie play, even in the few times that we got to see him last year. So, yeah, I could agree with you. I think he's probably in the mix for that fourth line role. And then two goals in this game also from the blue line, both from the same player, which is Brett Kulak. It was Kulak that was on the starting roster last year, right?
Yes.
I always get him and Culkin confused. So, yeah, I mean, Kulak, two goals, one assist for 3 points in the night. I don't know if you watched this one that intently, but I really liked what I saw from Kulak in this one. I wasn't all that sold on the 13 minutes that we saw Kanzig play, but I did like what we saw from Grossman in this one on the blue line as well. I thought that Grossman, you could really tell that he was the veteran of this group.
Yeah. And I think that what you're going to end up seeing is a four-way battle between Grossman and the three kids, Wotherspoon, Kulak, and Morrison for the seventh defensive spot.
Could be.
And Kulak did a very good job of jumping into the play when it was necessary, and that led to the third goal. He pinched in from the blue line and ended up being right in front of the net for the chance to deke out the goaltender and score. So,
yeah, Kulak's not a guy I generally think of as a big offensive defenseman, but I think that you're right. He did it when it was appropriate. He wasn't just looking for big shots or just trying to, you know, move in when it wasn't appropriate, and he made the best of it. I don't know. How would you kind of evaluate Kulak as a defenseman? Do you think he's more on the offensive side?
I think he's just an overall decent defenseman. Like, I wouldn't expect him to be, like, a 20-point player if he played a full season. But he can jump in the play. He can do lots of little things. I think he's more defensively responsible than he is offensively talented. But
yeah, see, I've always looked at him as sort of a stay-at-home D-man with an offensive touch.
Yeah. That's pretty much how I see him as well, and I think he's progressing to the point where the AHL's not going to be any more of a use for him, so I wouldn't be shocked if he won the spot as the seventh defenseman and playing a semi-regular game in Calgary.
Yeah, we'll discuss that a little bit more after these games, but you could very well be right. I have some thoughts that I'll share with you in a bit. The next game on the 30th of September, the Calgary Flames were at home hosting the Vancouver Canucks, and this was a 2-1 final in Calgary's favor. We had goals from Troy Brower and Matthew Tkachuk, and you and I were at this game. Fairly stacked Vancouver roster in terms of, you know, preseason rosters. It was funny that both Berchi and Granlund were out there, and you and I talked a little bit about those guys being former Flames. What were your overall thoughts on Berchi and Granlund?
I thought Granlund was the better of the two, but I thought they were both largely invisible. Like, if they were on the Flames roster, it'd be like, oh, they played too. Sort of like what Klimchuk and Poirier have brought this preseason.
Yeah, and I thought they had good chemistry together. They were on the ice a lot together, so we didn't see a lot in their time in Calgary, but we saw a lot in their stays at our various AHL homes. And you could definitely tell that those guys knew each other well out there. They got a lot of ice time just looking at the Vancouver forwards. Berchi was out there for 19 minutes and 18 seconds. Granlund for 19 minutes, 34 seconds, which was the longest ice time of any Vancouver forward. So it sort of makes you wonder. I think both of them are going to make Vancouver's team this year. What do you think?
Oh, I agree for sure.
But we're not here to talk about Vancouver. Let's talk about the Flames roster. Another fairly stacked roster. I mean, if we look up front, we had Stajan, Tkachuk, Hamilton, Higgins, Brouwer, Chiasson, Klimchuk, Shinkaruk, Hathaway, Jankowski, Ferland, and Bennett. On defense, we had Giordano, Weidman, Wotherspoon, Hamilton, England, and Shillington. And in net, we had Elliott and Parsons. So looking at this, well, first overall thoughts of this game. What do you think, Matt?
I thought Tkachuk and his line had very good chemistry throughout the game.
That was the line of Tkachuk, Bennett, and Brouwer.
And I thought a guy like Mark Jankowski struggled a bit in that game. Elliott and Parsons both were excellent in the net. Overall, the team looked decent. It's hard to make too many assumptions about this team due to the fact that up until yesterday's game against Winnipeg, we haven't seen Frolik or Backlund either. So the Flames have been playing more of their bottom end line players. And
which is not uncommon in the preseason.
No, but even in a game like that, you would normally be starting to see some of your upper tier talent. So
yeah, I mean, we've got Giordano out there, we've got Hamilton out there, so I mean, those guys are upper tier. We've been playing our starting goalie a few times, but I know what you're saying. Looking at the roster in this Vancouver game, one of the things I thought coming in was a very weird second line that they iced. So the first line out there was Tkachuk, Bennett, and Brouwer. The second line was Shinkaruk, Stajan, and Ferland. And I don't know what you thought, but I thought that Shinkaruk was the shining star of that second line. I thought that Stajan really looked out of place. He looked like he probably deserves a trip to Stockton. And Ferland just didn't fit with those two.
Yeah, I agree. Like, Ferland, it seems that he needs to be with other physical line mates in order to be himself more. Shinkaruk, he looked like he could slot in a number of lines throughout the lineup.
Yeah, Shinkaruk looked NHL ready to me, but I know what you're saying about Ferland. I think that the Flames keep trying to push him in an offensive direction, and they just need to say, you know what, this guy's just our big, heavy, I don't want to say heavy hitter, but he's our physical guy.
Yeah. Well, that's why earlier I was mentioning a line of like Ferland, Hamilton, and Hathaway, because each of those guys brings some physicality and can be a disturber line. And like, especially if you have Tkachuk with Bennett and Brouwer, like you can have two lines that will just absolutely be annoying and get under the other team's skin.
I think Hathaway and Ferland would be good line mates.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that Matt Stajan, in the first game, he was terrible. He could have easily had two or three goals in that game, but he made mistakes that prevented them. And again, he just did not look NHL caliber. And I think if the Flames keep him in the NHL, and it'll be in the press box type role where he only plays whenever somebody needs a day off.
It's an expensive popcorn eater.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but I think that with the precedent that they made with Mason Raymond last year, if Stajan...
Yeah, but look at how many tries Raymond got. I mean, he was here for most of the season.
I know, but expectations are that this team is not supposed to be a bottom five team now. So the Flames ended up being a bottom five team last year. That's not acceptable. And if a guy like Stajan is not performing up to snuff, then they should do the exact same thing that they did with Raymond and assign him to Stockton and maybe look at a buyout in the offseason.
Well, I think that there's a lot more motivation to send him to Stockton than to have him sit in the press box. You know, if somebody wants to take him off waivers, be our guest. I don't think anyone will. But I think that there's motivation to say, you know what, you're in Stockton, you're playing, earn your way back up, than just sit in the press box and watch. And I think that for a contract as big as his, it's easier to justify as well that, you know what, he's still playing at least.
Yeah, and he's being the leader in Stockton.
Exactly. I could see them put a C on him down there. Third line in this game was Chris Higgins, Freddie Hamilton, and Alex Chiasson. I thought that Chiasson looked better than he did in the first game against Edmonton, but still making some offensive mistakes. And Chris Higgins, almost invisible out there.
he was only good on the penalty kill. You know, like, you can't have a designated penalty kill forward out there. So, it's unfortunate, but I don't see Higgins making the cut.
The Flames are giving him a lot of chances. He just doesn't seem to be rising to the occasion. Like, he's played in a lot of preseason games and got a lot of minutes in.
Yeah. Well, you always got to try somebody who's a legitimate competitor for a spot, but I just don't see him making the cut. The Flames have too many good forwards.
And the fourth line in this game, again, I thought, just like the second line, sort of a weird matchup, was Klimchuk, Jankowski, and Hathaway. Hathaway and Jankowski had the least minutes of all forwards, playing just over 10.5 minutes each. I thought that Jankowski was invisible for a lot of his minutes. He was a minus one on the game. He had 4 penalty minutes. But I didn't notice him at all, really, as a forward doing anything good offensively.
No, and I think that was the reason why he got sent to Stockton today. The Flames, with the amount of competition they have, it's better to have Jankowski playing on the first line in Stockton and eating 20 minutes instead of, and allowing, say, a guy like Hamilton to be the fourth line center instead of having Jankowski up. He's going to be a quality player sooner than later, but you have to have an eye towards development as well, and him playing 20 plus minutes a night down there is probably better than 8 or 9 up here.
Sometimes we as fans get very excited to see the new young players. We get excited to see these guys coming up. And I've said for a while, and I'll say again, that I think the best place for Jankowski to start the year is in the AHL. We saw him do pretty good down there when he played at the end of the season in the A last year. I think that, you know, I don't think there's any harm to starting him in the AHL. It's not a permanent banishment, but I think it's the best place to start him off.
Yeah, like I wouldn't expect him to play the entire season in Stockton. I think as soon as there's an injury to a center or even a winger, possibly, that he would be one of the first recalls. I don't expect him to play more than half the season down there.
Before we move off this game, just wanted to talk about the blue line tandems. We had Giordano Hamilton. That tandem looked good. You could tell, though, that Giordano's so used to playing with Brody. Like, there's things that he was doing where he was anticipating how Brody would act, and Hamilton wasn't quite doing those. But I thought that Hamilton looked good. I mean, if he can keep this up, I'm expecting a rebound year for Dougie Hamilton. I don't know about you.
Well, I wouldn't exactly say that last year was a down year. He just had...
Okay, first half, I guess. Like,
yeah.
First half of the year was a bad year. He came back in the second
half.
Yeah,
like, he had a career year in points, so it's not like he was terrible or anything. But Hamilton, I'm expecting him to proceed in his development. He's a good young player, and he's on his way to being a top-pairing defenseman. The Flames are just lucky that they have 3 of them. And I'm expecting, like, especially after how Brody struggled in the Jets game, I'm expecting him to remain with Giordano instead of being put on the other side like he was with Weidman, because that just really did not work.
Well, Weidman in general hasn't worked. I mean, in the Vancouver game, we saw Weidman and Shillington together, and you and I kept saying, like, Weidman, he was looking like a liability at times. He wasn't fighting hard. He was letting pucks go by him. This guy, after seeing this Vancouver game especially, I'm a little bit nervous about Dennis Weidman this year.
Well, if they can shelter him on the third pairing and basically just use his cannon of a shot on the power play, that wouldn't be the worst thing. It's just...
That might be another guy you see riding the pine or up in the press box.
Yeah. Well, especially if a game is necessary to have more of a defensive outlook to it, I could see the winner of the 4 defensemen battling each other getting those games and Weidman sitting. Whereas a game against, say, Columbus, you can get away with having Weidman out there.
Yeah, and I don't know. I mean, between Weidman and Stajan, that's $10 million, just over $10 million the Flames are going to have to do something with this year. That's a tough spot to be in.
And that's why the Flames don't have a first-line right winger. So,
and probably why we still don't have a Gaudreau contract, too.
Probably. It's frustrating, but at least there's about $15 million in contracts that are movable or coming off the books at the end of the year. So, looking forward to the Flames making a run at a guy like TJ Oshie in the offseason.
That'd be interesting. And just to wrap this game up, Brian Elliott saw the majority of time in net. Tyler Parsons played the final period. I think that in both games you and I have seen him in, Elliott's looked spectacular. I'm very excited about him as our starting goaltender. He looks poised. He looks like he's ready to go. He looks like he knows what he needs to do. I don't have anything bad to say about Elliott.
He's a top five goaltender in the NHL, period. And
a lot of people say, you know, he's never played a lot of games, but I think in St. Louis, it wasn't that he couldn't do it. It's that he didn't have to because they had the 1A, 1B. But I think this could be a real breakout year for Elliott to show people what he's capable of.
Yeah. And even then, I wouldn't expect him to play more than 60 games because you have one of the top backups in the NHL as well. So why not keep them both fresh and do it that way? You know, it's not like the Flames are in a Kiprusoff situation where the other goaltender is some guy that should be in the AHL. So you've got two top-end goaltenders. Use them.
That's true. It's funny because we said that in the last couple of years. We said that on paper, we had one of the best tandems in the league with Hiller and Ramo. And last year, that whole thing fell apart, but based on what we've seen from these guys this year, I again think that we may have the best tandem in the league.
There might be a couple of teams that have a better goaltender, like, say, New Jersey with Schneider, but the backup's not nearly as good as Johnson.
Watch it. I'm not saying we have the best goalies in the league, but I think if you look at the tandem as a pair, we probably have the best tandem. There's always those guys. I mean, New Jersey did that for years with Brodeur. We saw it with Waugh, where even with Kipper, nobody knows who the backup is. It doesn't matter.
Hey, Craig Billington was a decent backup.
But you know what I mean? Like, we did it even with Kiprusoff, where it's who's the backup now? I don't know. Some guy who does karate chops in the shootout. Like, nobody knows their names. But I think that if you look at the team, I think that we have the best tandem going into the season.
I agree. And it's a nice departure from last season. So it'll be interesting to see how those two guys play throughout the year and who earns the contract moving forward.
It's interesting if you think about it that Jordan Siglett kept his job after last season. He's the goalie coach. It shows that the Flames didn't think it was the coaching. It was, you know, the goalies themselves.
Yeah. You can only blame a person so much for something going wrong. And
well, if it was one person, I could see, but having kind of all the goalies fall apart, that's usually when you'd end up having a coaching change.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like we had one bad goalie where you can say, okay, it's not the coach, it's the goalie. Generally, when you have all your goalies perform terribly, you'd have a coaching change.
Well, again, there's some responsibility on the goaltenders, and none of them played well at all. And like Ramo, he did make some adjustments after he got sent to Stockton in the early part of last year. And he got better after that, and that was largely due to Siglett. So
wasn't good enough.
I'm giving him some credit. So if the two goalies...
Oh, I think Siglett's a good goalie coach. Don't get me wrong. But it's interesting that with, you know, the head coach changing and some of the staff changing, that he wasn't one of the pieces changed.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the last game here, and then we'll move on. The last game was played last night. This was the first October game, which means that it's almost time for the season to start. And the Jets came to Calgary, where we hosted, and lost 4-0. Which, if you look at the game, I mean, Calgary had more shots. They had a better faceoff percentage. Matt, you were at this game. I mean, what happened here? The Flames just kind of fell apart.
Well, the first goal was a bit of a fluke. The guy was behind the Flames net, passed it out front. Johnson got most of it, but it trickled over the line. Not much you can do. The second one was a clearing attempt that bounced off of three players and landed right on the stick of a Jets player. Nothing that the goalie could do. The third one was just one heck of a good shot. And the fourth goal after Gillies came in, again, was one heck of a good shot. It's unfortunate, but, especially after only surrendering 7 shots through the first half of the game to surrender 4 goals, it happens that way sometimes. And as much as one would like to criticize Johnson for allowing that many goals on that few shots, it's one of those where any goaltender would have surrendered those goals. So it just, they all happened right, you know, with so few shots on him that it happens that way sometimes.
Johnson had 6 shots on him and 3 of them he let in. Gillies had 18 shots and he saved 17 of them.
Yeah, and it was only the first shot that he let in. And sometimes that happens. Unfortunate when it does happen, but it is what it is. And you got to also remember, I think that's the first time that Johnson's ever played in Calgary as a NHL goaltender. So you got to figure that there was some butterflies there, considering he is from Calgary and grew up a Flames fan. So it's preseason.
And I think the fact that Johnson looked good in his first appearance sort of equals out now with this appearance. And, you know, I wouldn't say, oh, we've got a, you know, a terrible backup. I think that he should get another look before the preseason's done.
Yeah, and you can understand why he would have some nerves in this game. So I don't expect that to be a recurring problem at all. And it is what it is. Move on. And the team on the whole played well. I particularly enjoyed the physicality from the two lines that we had out there. So if the Flames do go with that kind of physicality, it will be an interesting season in terms of being more of a Brian Burke thuggish style of team.
Yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't call it that, but I think it's definitely going to have some grit to it. Or is, you know, I think it'll be a truculent team.
But that is what the team needs to be successful. Like, if you've looked at all the Cup winners from, like, 2007 forward, except for when Detroit won and the Penguins won twice, each of those teams have been very physical, punishing teams. So if the Calgary Flames are going to be a successful playoff team down the road after this season, through this season and into the years following, they're going to need to be able to play that rough, tough, thump 'em everywhere style of game. And it was encouraging to see that raw physicality coming out more and more. And I'm thinking that part of what this team is going to be, especially on the fourth line, is that physical brand of hockey. And I think with Tkachuk probably making the NHL roster, having two lines that are just going to be disturbers is going to be a good thing.
Yeah, and I think if we look at some of the players that have been cut and some of the players still around, that makes sense. After the Winnipeg game, the Flames did their highest profile cuts. We started the camp with, I think, just over 60 players, and we're down to 32, so they've cut more than half. But, Matt, I think you could agree that this last set of cuts that happened on October 3rd is probably the biggest names. Going down to the Stockton Heat, we had Jon Gillies, Ryan Culkin, Oliver Shillington, Mark Jankowski, Morgan Klimchuk, and Emile Poirier. There's been a whole bunch of cuts since the last show. We won't go through them all because they're not all names everyone's going to know, but we'll post them on the website in the show notes. But of those guys cut that we just talked about, I'm not surprised about Gillies. I think the Gillies we knew was going to be the number one AHL guy. Culkin doesn't surprise me. I think that he didn't show enough to battle for one of the open jobs. Though I do think Culkin's going to have to show himself soon because he's getting old to be an AHL guy if he's not going to make it to the NHL.
Yeah, I think in his particular case that because he's been injured repeatedly, that he'll, like Seeloff, he'll be getting more of an opportunity to show that he is progressing forward. Whether he emerges as an NHL player or not is still to be seen, but he may end up being a useful piece in a trade, sort of like how the Flames utilize Seeloff to get Chase on.
And Shillington, as much as he's got potential, he's barely 19. Like, he's still a young player, and I think that sending him to the AHL, giving him a ton of minutes in the A, is going to do more for his career than making him a number 5-6 in the NHL.
Yeah, and I'm expecting this time next year that he will be earning one of those spots as a 5-6 or even a 4, possibly, depending on how well he does you can tell his offensive instincts are just top notch. It's just rounding out the defensive side of the game, but working with Todd Gill, that's just a matter of time. And he has improved significantly over the past 12 months. If he makes a similar jump, you're talking about an all-star caliber player in the moving forward.
I hope so. He could be a nice fit on a second pairing with Hamilton.
Exactly. And wouldn't that be a fun foursome?
That would be. And if we look up front, we sent down three first-round selections. Jankowski, I know you thought it would either be Jankowski or Tkachuk to make this team. I'm not surprised Janko's heading down. He's a young player. He's a first-year pro. He needs some seasoning, and he's going to play a ton of minutes in the AHL, so I think that's a good move.
Yeah, and again, if Tkachuk struggled, then I'm sure he would have been returned to London, but he looked pretty much right there with the other guys on his line, so no reason to send him back. And it's an either-or situation, and Tkachuk was the better player, so Jankowski goes down.
I thought that Klimchuk looked fine for what we'd expect in exhibition, but like Janko, I think he just needs some time in the AHL. He needs to round out his game, become a more complete player, and the AHL is a better environment for him to do that.
Well, with all three of the first-rounders, Janko, Klimchuk, and Poirier, like especially last year, they were more focusing on rounding out their 200-foot game. And like that's why you saw depressed scoring totals. Like I think Klimchuk only had like 4 or 5 goals last year. And like while that's disappointing, like if you're just reading a stat sheet, you could see in both of their cases that they were learning how to be NHL caliber players. And Jankowski is further along in that because he's already been a good defensive player in the NCAA. Now, I think this year for all three of them, they have to show that they can contribute offensively and be those go-to guys in the offensive department.
I mean, as Theo Fleury told us when he was on the show last year, is these guys are so used to during junior being told, you know what, just get the puck and go to the net. Everyone else do the hard work. And you have to now teach them the whole game. You have to teach them to play when they don't have the puck on their stick. And I was a little bit disappointed, like you said, by Klimchuk last year when you look at the score sheet. But watching him in the preseason and watching some AHL footage from last year, I think that Klimchuk may actually develop into a nice NHL player.
And I'm not writing off Emile Poirier either. I think if those two guys make the NHL, they will be more in the mold of Michael Frolik, where just a good defensive two-way forward who can chip
utility
in.
Utility forward.
Yeah. Like if you're expecting either of them to be top six forwards, no. Like, unless your team's crap, then maybe, but you know, those guys, you're going to, in, like, say, 2 years from now, when we're needing young replacement players that are cheap, those are the types of guys that you're going to want to bring in. Say, like, if you want to move a contract, like for Leaks, just to free up some cap for, say, re-signing Tkachuk or something like that, that's where you need those guys to slot in and develop into reliable third, fourth line guys. So that way you can kind of be like Chicago, where they just roll over the bottom end of their roster.
Well, every team's yeah. doing that now. Everyone's rolling their bottom six every
yeah.
season. Or
and
two.
As long as they can keep that up, where they're finding good players that they can actually slot in as NHL talent, then that's a good thing. It's just you have to wait and see how they respond in the AHL if they can figure out the offensive side of their game.
Watching Jankowski, he seemed like he just the speed of the game at the NHL level he wasn't ready for. And watching Poirier, and we saw this last year in the A2, he was inconsistent. I mean, he had some stretches where he looked brilliant and some stretches where he didn't. And I think in order to be on an NHL guy and play, you know, 70 to 80 games here, you've got to be more consistent than Poirier. And again, I'm not writing him off, but I just think he'll do better being seasoned for another year at least in the AHL.
Yeah, and like if Poirier struggles all year and like has a season like he did last year, then I could see the Flames possibly utilizing him in a trade, sort of like they did with Granlund or even Berchi, but
I don't know if I want to go as far as comparing to Berchi yet.
No. But you know what I mean, like where it just couldn't
trade a good young
that
asset for another young asset.
Yeah, and you know, we can always dial up the Canucks again and maybe get Brock Besser off them or something.
now they can have a whole line. They can have Poirier, Granlund, and Berchi.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, just tell them, you got to collect the whole set. Over 5 years, we'll give you two more defensemen and you're good to go.
Yeah.
Looking at other names that got sent down, not in this last cut, but over time, Rasmus Andersson is a big name people would know, not surprising. He needs to work on his conditioning. Mason McDonald also going to the AHL. Ryan Lomberg, fun to watch, not quite ready. I think Mangiapane, same thing. Hunter Smith, not ready. Jon Gillies, no surprise there. So I don't know about you, none of these cuts are surprising. There's nobody I've looked at yet and gone, surprising that this guy's cut.
Yeah, like if the Flames say they cut Tkachuk, then that would be like, okay, that's a shock, but they haven't. So none of these players are really a surprise.
So Matt, looking at the roster, why don't we go through position by position and figure out what we think our opening day roster is going to look like. Let's start in net. We got three goalies left in camp, Brian Elliott, Chad Johnson, David Rittich. I think we'd both agree there's no question here. Rittich gets cut, and I think Rittich becomes our AHL backup.
Yeah, I agree. I think Mason McDonald goes down to the ECHL just so he can play most of the games. And Gillies is a starter, plays probably 45 games this year, and Rittich picking up the balance when they play back-to-backs.
Sometimes they play, what is it, the AHL? They play like three games in a row?
Yeah, sometimes, yeah.
So, yeah, no, I think Rittich will be a decent backup there. I think that if you needed to, you could pull McDonald up for some of those third games. But, yeah, I agree with you. That was going to be my next question. Where do you see McDonald? I think he'll end up in Adirondack playing, at least starting the season for the ECHL team.
Yeah, and in case of injuries, it just depends on who gets hurt. Like, say Rittich got hurt, then I think the Flames would just go sign or acquire some other AHL backup.
Well, there's
guy.
Already a couple. I think there's at least one goalie who's already on an AHL contract who's at the Stockton Heat camp now.
Yeah, so you'd likely see that guy fill in instead. If Gillies got hurt, then McDonald would come up and be the AHL starter for a while. So
in goal, we have Ryan Farhager at camp right now. So that's probably going to be their sort of, I don't know if he plays for the ECHL team or what, but yeah,
might be the E backup.
Yeah, I don't see the Flames necessarily going out and signing an A backup. I think there's plenty of them out there that the A team would just sign one. On defense, the Flames have 11 defensemen left. Do you think we'll run 7 or 8 defensemen?
7.
So we count, Ladislav Smead is counted in that 11. Let's take him out. That gives us 10 defensemen left at camp. We need to cut 3 of them. The guys left, Joki Paka, Giordano, Weidman, Brody, Grossman, who's on a PTO, Wotherspoon, Hamilton, England, Morrison, and Kulak. Why don't I start here? I'm honestly surprised Morrison's still around. He didn't have a great AHL year last year. I don't know. I haven't thought he had a great preseason, so I think that Morrison ends up getting sent down for sure. I think Kulak, Wotherspoon, and Grossman will fight for that last spot. And as much as I want to say I think it's Wotherspoon's time, I honestly see the Flames signing Grossman there.
Yeah. I would prefer them giving the spot to one of either Kulak or Wotherspoon. Of the two, I think Kulak's done a slightly better job, but if they give it to Wotherspoon, I'm not going to complain either way.
I think Wotherspoon's been the number one guy for longer.
Yeah. Like, I don't, you know, if they went with Wotherspoon, I'd be like, okay, sure, fine. You know, there's no problem sending Kulak to be the number one defenseman in Stockton, so no big deal. I think if Wotherspoon or Kulak can't beat out Grossman, then Grossman will be signed. Overall, that would be kind of disappointing, but it's not a bad situation to have a quality veteran guy like Grossman as the 7.
Well, and I mean, if you look at it too, both Wotherspoon and Kulak are young. They're 20. Wotherspoon's 23 and Kulak's 22. Grossman's an older guy. I think part of this is going to depend, and I'm still of the belief that there's going to be some movement on the back end. I don't know that we're going to have Dennis Weidman here all year. And if the Flames think they might be losing a veteran defenseman, they might want to bring another veteran defenseman in sort of as a replacement.
Yeah. And additionally, the Flames may want to have an extra guy in case of the expansion draft as well. So who knows?
I could see Grossman getting a deal either way, even if he doesn't start in the NHL. I could see him getting a deal and being sent down. But I just, looking at the back end and the fact that Wotherspoon's been given a lot of chances, but he's never really stuck. I mean, he had a recall a little while ago where they didn't play him at all. What was that, 2 years ago?
Yeah.
And Kulak started last year and went down, and we didn't really hear from him since. So I'm not really sure they have the faith in either of those guys right now.
Yeah. Well, I think both of the young guys are NHL caliber defensemen. Like, I think if they needed to, and like say two of the guys got hurt and you had to run Spoon and Kulak as the third pairing, I don't think they'd be particularly bad.
I think Wotherspoon or Kulak will get time here. I just don't see the benefit of having them sit on the bench as a number seven.
No.
I think that Grossman makes more sense as a veteran to play as a number seven. And even if he stays a number seven, even if, you know, Wotherspoon jumps up and plays and Grossman's that last minute number seven replacement, to me that just makes the most sense. I really don't want to see Spooner sitting on the bench.
Yeah. Well, I think with them, if the two young guys can't beat out one of the top six guys, then Grossman will be signed. And it's debatable whether Wotherspoon or Kulak is actually better than Weidman at this point, so just have to wait and see.
So on the forward side, the Flames have 18 forwards currently at camp, two of those with PTO and Dan Preble, who's injured. Good assumption they'll carry 14 forwards?
Yeah, and just kind of put Preble in the AHL, because I think once he's better, he's just going to be sent down as just a rehab assignment.
Well, they don't know what they've got with him. So yeah, I think he'd definitely get sent down at least to just take a look at. You're not going to do that at the NHL level.
All right, so that's 17, so we got to find three cuts.
So let me read through the list of names that are still there. We've got Lyndon Vay, Michael Backlund, Lance Boma, Matt Stajan, Matt Tkachuk. Chris Higgins is still here on a PTO. Laurie Koprakowski is still here on a PTO. That's part-time tryout for those that don't know. Sean Monahan, Freddie Hamilton, Troy Brower, Alex Chason, Hunter Shinkarik, Brian Boley, Garnet Hathaway, Mike Frolik, Michael Ferland, and Sam Bennett. Johnny Gaudreau is not included in that list because he's not currently at camp, so let's add him in. I think we get this deal done in time. We need to make about three cuts here. Who do you see going down?
I don't see Chris Higgins, for one, being signed, because I don't think he's separated himself from any of the other bottom six forwards. Korpikoski, I could see being signed. I think he played rather well with Backlund and Frolik.
That'd be an interesting line, Korpikoski, Backlund, and Frolik. I think if nothing else, it gives the new benchmark. And we've talked about this every year. Who's the benchmark? Who do you have to beat for a job? I think if Korpikoski gets signed, he's the guy you got to beat for a job on the NHL roster.
Yeah. I don't think Vay has done enough to be signed. I don't think Chason has done enough to be retained as a top 12 forward. And Stajan and Bolig have both disappointed significantly. So,
well, when is Bolig not disappointed?
Well, he's been a useful player in the past, but his job is quickly going away because the designated fighter position is kind of going away. So I would probably keep him as one of the spare forwards and only play him when the other team has more of a physical lineup. But, yeah.
So you'd cut Vay? Who else would you cut?
I'd probably cut Higgins, Stajan, Vay, and probably Chason. So,
Chason, really? I just don't see. I think they've put a lot of, I don't know why, but they put a lot of sort of marketing into Chason. I don't see Chason going down.
He wouldn't be bad as the 14th forward. Like, if you're going to have 13.
We traded an AHL player for him, but I
the 13th and 14th forward, in my mind, if you kept Chason and Bullig in those two spots, that would be perfectly fine.
I think the Flames will then Lyndon Vay to the AHL. I think that was kind of a given going into the season. I think Matt Stajan ends up in the AHL. I think that's going to shock a lot of people, but for us, I think Stajan goes down. I think Tkachuk will play his 10 games, but I don't look at him as being a full-timer this year. I think they cut Higgins. I'm on the fence about Koprakowski. I think it'll depend. I think they have to put him on a veteran lineup in the next couple games to see how he looks. I think Hamilton will make the team. Chiasson will make the team. And Shinkarik will make the team. I can see the Flames waving Bolig and send him down. And I'm not sure what I would do with Hathaway. I think at this point I would keep Hathaway up as one of the last forwards. Yeah.
I think Hathaway is going to be the Flames version of Andrew Shaw for what he did with Chicago. Just being that generic pest, get under your skin. And he has shown an ability to get some offense in his game, so...
Hopefully we don't have to pay him like they're doing Andrew Shaw.
True, but the Flames need to have homegrown guys that can be that type of guy.
Well, and I think as an overall pest, I'd much rather have Hathaway and Ferland than Ferland
Same
and Bolig.
Because at least Hathaway can play and be a responsible forward, where Bolig doesn't really have the talent level necessary.
No, so I think you'll see Bolig. I think he gets dropped to Stockton. Maybe he even gets dropped Adirondack. We'll see. And I don't know if he'll be down there all year. I think if there's an injury to Hathaway or Ferland, he might come up for a few. But I don't look at him a full-time NHL.
Neither do I.
I think he had his chance. He had his chance last year. They put him in some offensive scenarios, and he didn't do anything.
Yeah, like with Bullock, if they'd opt to keep him as the 13th, 14th forward, that's fine. If they want to play him in Stockton, that's fine too. Like, it just depends on what they want to do. If they want to save a couple hundred grand and have him in Stockton and have either Hathaway or Hamilton in his place, that works. If not, you know, that's fine too. It just depends on what they feel they need moving forward.
I think some of that may come down to a Gaudreau contract too, and how much do we need
exactly
to bury.
That's exactly why.
Yeah. I mean, Bolig's making... he's making over a million, so they may need to free up just over a million and send him down.
Yeah, well, they'd only save 900,000, and then the replacement player's cost would be 600,000, so overall they'd be saving just over a quarter of $1 million. But that would actually be necessary if, say, Gaudreau gets 7.5, so we'll see.
Let's talk about Gaudreau. We're just a few days from the season, and we haven't seen him on the Flames ice. He's not with the team. He's still unsigned. There's been some information coming out this week from Eric Francis and from a few other people. Gaudreau camp looks like they're asking for about $8 million. The Flames want to sign him in line with Monahan and Giordano, which is about $6.7 to $6.8 million, somewhere in there. So it sounds like we have just over $1 million backlog in terms of the difference between these guys. I think this deal is going to get done. I mean, there's not a lot of negotiating power on Gaudreau's side. I can't see him being locked out.
No,
but
not at all.
I don't know. I don't see this deal. I don't see him not playing the home opener or even the season opener. I just think that, where do you think they're going to land, Matt?
Well, Monahan signed for 6.375, and I think Gaudreau being the better offensive player, I think $1 million more. So 7.375 would make the best compromise deal. So if you look at that over 8 years, I think that would be ideal and go from there. I don't see the Flames offering them the exact same years as Monahan, just for the flexibility of adapting to a higher deal afterwards.
So you think you'll get a shorter deal?
Longer,
okay.
Yeah. And that way, it just make... Because, like, you look at Chicago, they both had Kane and Taze both expiring at the same time, and that really screwed up their team. So I think that spacing out the contracts, like, even if it's just a one-year difference, it just allows the GM at the time to have a little bit more flexibility of shedding a contract or whatever. So we'll see.
If we look at sort of the Flames' last superstar, if you will, which was Jerome McGinley, he made $7 million, pretty much right on $7 million for a large portion of his Flames career. So I think it would be fair to pay Gaudreau in that 7 million range. I think 8's too much, especially if we're going long term.
Yeah.
I think, you know, and when I'm talking numbers here, I'm talking about the average cap hit. I think you're going to see a front loaded deal here where he's going to make a lot up front and less overall, but it's about that average cap hit. I think the average cap hit's going to be about 7.3. I think like you said, that's fair. It's more than Monahan. It's more than the captain, which I know they don't want to do, but the captain's aging too.
And you have to compromise. Like, you know, like he can point to Vladimir Tarasenko, who he had a very similar last two seasons with, and Tarasenko got 7.5. Now, Gaudreau's a younger player, so, you know, slightly less, where Tarasenko is on a second contract. So, you know, overall, I think that would be a fair compromise situation. Just slightly less, 7.375, and call it a day.
And there's been a whole bunch of stories out. I don't want to spread rumors that we don't know, but, I mean, there's been rumors that, you know, the Flames haven't called them back and all sorts of things, the Gaudreau camp, but... You know what, I think either way, this deal gets done.
Yeah, I don't think there's been...
I think the Flames are waiting to move some money right now, and I think that might be a big reason why
it's not done
yet.
Well, like, I don't think there's been a huge rush to get it done. Like, we saw Gaudreau in the World Cup. He's in mid-season form already, so you don't need to worry about him having to get up to speed. Like, he's at top-level speed right now, so who cares? And... If the Flames...
Well, part of that's just getting them in with the new coach and getting them into the new system.
But again, that's not a big deal, because Gaudreau's good enough where that doesn't matter as much. But overall, like, if the Flames are trying to, say, trade Dennis Wiedemann, say, if you don't have any cap flexibility because Gaudreau's contract is locked in, then the other team can kind of dictate, well, you have to do this or that in order for us to take this contract. And... having that flexibility of, well, we want to trade you this guy, so we'll do this instead. It just makes it a little easier for Treliving to potentially make a trade with Wiedemann instead of being locked in. Oh, I only have $300,000 in cap space. I am kind of screwed. So, you know what I mean? It just makes it a little easier on the trade market to have that flexibility and all that.
According to generalfanager.com, the Flames are sitting with roughly $7.9 million left under the cap. So, I mean, if they sign Gaudreau, let's say, for $7.3, that gives us about $600,000 to play with. We send a guy like Bolig to the farm. We send a guy like Stajan to the farm. Oh, no, Stajan wouldn't come off because he's over $1 million. So,
oh, no, $900,000 gets deleted. So
okay,
we'd save $300,000
so you could on free, either. You could free up about $1.5 million if you send those two guys down.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, it's doable. I think that the Flames are kind of waiting for a couple other pieces. From what I've heard is the Flames are sort of waiting to see if they can make a move, and if not, they're just going to sign the contract.
Which makes sense. Like, there's no rush. Like, oh, you know, Gaudreau's not going to play in a preseason game. Like, that really makes much of a difference. So...
we have about a week left until the season starts on the 12th when we go to Edmonton against the Oilers. And I have no concerns this isn't going to get done by the 12th. I think that for Gaudreau to lock out, it's going to be bad for him, bad for his career. If he doesn't play, if he, you know, locks out. We've seen guys like Trouba who've asked for a trade because they can't get a deal done. Again, I don't see that happening here.
Well, plus in Trouba's case, the Jets are stacked on defense. So, like, he's not getting the opportunity that he would like. And I can understand that from his point of view. So, all things considered, that's one situation. But when you're the guy here, and there is no better player on the Flames in their organization top to bottom than Gaudreau, there's not that, you know, being buried in the depth chart like Trouba. So...
yeah, I know a lot of people are worried about this deal. I think it's going to get done. I think it might even get done, you know, the night before. It doesn't really matter, but I don't see the Flames starting the season without Johnny Gaudreau in the lineup.
No, and like even if you balance out the say he signs for 8 years, the difference between the two teams, say being at like 7.3 versus 8, is only like $4 to $5 million over the duration of a contract, which, all things considered, that's not that big of a deal. So, I am not concerned at all. Like, it's just a matter of getting pen on paper.
Gaudreau's 23 right now. If he signs an 8-year deal, that'll put him under contract till he's about 31. I think that if we can get an 8-year deal done, $7 million is going to look, hopefully, if he keeps in his projection, $7 million is going to look like a good deal by the end, because we'll have him right through his prime.
Yeah. And realistically, at that point, you can sign him again for another 7 or 8 year deal. So,
yeah, you see how he's doing at that point. I mean,
yeah, like I could see him even signing like a 7-year contract instead, just to allow his next contract to be a similar 7-8 year length. So we'll see. I'm not concerned either way.
I know there's been a lot of talk about him, but I think we'll see what happens. But I think that by our next show, just before the season starts, we'll be talking about a Gaudreau deal.
Yeah, same here.
So, I mean, the Flames are going to have to do some maneuvering somehow. You can't really go into the season with $600,000 left under cap. You want some flexibility. And I think, to me, that's going to be the interesting thing as we look forward over the next week is what happens here. And that's where I think you may not see a guy like Grossman sign, simply because we don't want to put any more money on the books till we get Gaudreau done. But it's going to be interesting to see what happens with the cap. The cap breakdown right now, 41.17% of our cap's gone to the 13 forwards that we have under contract. Six defensemen are taking up 35.9% of the cap. And our two goalies, who we've got a steal of a deal on both, 5.75% of the cap for goalies. So it's going to be interesting, but between Weidman and Stajan, you've got almost $8 million there between the two of them. We have to move. I think that either way that we look at it, we have to move one of those contracts.
Even if it's just to the farm.
Yeah.
To free
we just
up an extra 600,000 or 300,000.
And that's where I think even if Stajan plays okay, he may get sent to the farm. Just say, you know what? We just need to free up some money right now.
It'll be interesting to see exactly what happens, because the Flames really do need to find somebody to play on the right wing with Gaudreau and Monahan. And I'm just not sure exactly. Like, none of the young players or Chiasson have shown enough where offensively that they can actually fit there.
Well, and that's one of the reasons I'd like to get Gaudreau into a preseason game, is so we can actually try somebody there instead of speculating.
That's where it's a little tough, because you don't want to rob, like, say, putting for a leak on that first line, because then that creates a problem with the third line, and, you know, it just messes up everything.
Yeah, but
so
I think that's where you could, say, throw Shinkarik up there, or Chiasson, or whoever they might want in that position, and just try them out with, you know, I mean, right now you could try them with Monahan, but I'd really like to try out, at least in the last game, the one against Vancouver, try out what we think might be our first line.
Yeah, fun times ahead.
So it'll be interesting to see what happens there. Looking at the team, though, and looking at where we might have holes, it was interesting to see today in the NHL a whole bunch of guys put on waivers. Your usual, I guess, waiver guys, 13th forward, 7th defenseman, you and I talked about this earlier. I was surprised Peter Budaj was put on waivers. I'm surprised that guy's still around. This is a guy, I think, if you had the cap room, the Flames aren't going to sign him or pick him up off waivers, but he could make a good AHL backup to a young guy like Gillies.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what the Kings have him under contract for, is to be their veteran AHL goaltender. And he did a good job for their farm team last year, so I agree with you, but, you know, that's what the Kings are doing and using him for exactly, so.
And the other interesting name on this list, former Flame, or I guess Flames prospect, Tim Erixon. We all remember the big deal back in 2011 when Erixon forced the Flames to trade him to New York. And honestly, Erickson's never lived up to his ambitions. He's played 93 NHL games so far, and I think, honestly, that's probably going to be the bulk of his career.
Yeah.
He's on his way back to the AHL. I think that I would say that Erickson's time is a, I mean, he's had some good time in the NHL where he's had some good chunks of play, but he's on his way to Wilkes-Barre Scranton. He's in the Pittsburgh system now. He was included in the Kessel deal, and I think this is one of those guys, sort of like a Pavel Brendl in a way, where you're going to see him included in a lot of big deals, but he's just not going to go anywhere.
Yeah. What I'd find amusing is if the Flames actually picked him up on waivers and then just send him to the farm afterwards.
That would be kind of interesting. I don't know. I don't think that new management has any attachment to this guy.
No.
If Sutter was still in office, maybe. But I think new management, there's nothing that's compelling about this guy. And is just an AHL defenseman.
Yeah.
There's better.
True enough.
You know, I think that he's just marginal. But, I mean, if you look at Brendel, who I compared him to, he got traded to Philadelphia in the Sammy Kapanen deal. He got traded to the Rangers. It was Brendel, Jan Havlik, Kim Johnson, a third for a first-round pick, and the rights to Lindros. Like, he was involved in some bigger deals, but he was never a key piece of it. It was always that kind of throw-in guy, and I think that Erickson's going to be that way. And he's 25. I mean, it's sad to see, but I'm glad the Flames let this kid go.
Yeah, and we have Hunter Shinkarik thanks to him, so all good on our end.
Yeah, it's true. I guess in a roundabout way, Shinkarik is the product of that deal.
Yes, him and Wotherspoon. So we still got a couple of good young players in our organization.
Two guys who might make the team this year, as opposed to Erickson, who if he was still here probably wouldn't, and would probably be overpaid, and we'd be looking for a way to get rid of that contract. Matt, anything else about preseason, anything else about this team you want to chat about this show?
Well, I think the Flames overall, if they fill out their lineup properly, they'll have a good bottom nine and a good top six for defensemen and two good quality goaltenders. It's just figuring out that one right wing spot on the first line. Beyond that, the team's good. I'm somewhat expecting this team to make the playoffs this year. Not sure. It depends on if the right winger on the first line can generate some actual chemistry with Monahan and Gaudreau.
Why don't we save those predictions until we see the opening day roster?
Yeah.
Because we still have a lot of positions and cuts to make. But yeah, I agree with you. There's promise coming up. We still have two more preseason games, and we don't even have an opening day roster yet.
Exactly. But it's just encouraging to see that the Flames have taken some steps forward to carry on in the rebuild and, you know, looking more like an actual good team instead of what happened last year. So it's good to see. That's all.
Before we go, I wanted to let fans know, if you don't know already, about the Red Rally, the Flames fan event that's happening on October 8th. This is going to be a family event from 10:30 in the morning till 4 p.m. Tickets are $10, and you can buy them online or from the Dome. And it's actually quite an interesting event. They've done a few of these Red Rallies in the past. At 10:30, the doors open. At 11 o'clock, there's going to be, and you can see all the information at flamesredrally.com. But at 11 o'clock, there's going to be a Flames practice open to the public. And Glenn Gulletson will be mic'd up, so you'll be able to hear what the coaches telling the players, what they're talking about, that sort of thing. There's alumni autographs. There's going to be autographs for the fans, from the players, from the alumni. I guess they're bringing a bunch of the guys out onto the concourse after the practice. So it'll be interesting. Harvey the Hound's going to be there. I don't know about you, Matt. I think it's interesting they're doing this Red Rally in the preseason. We've seen it done before where it was the day after a tough loss and nobody really wanted to be there. And I think it's an interesting time of year to do it when there's just high expectations.
Yeah, more of a hopeful time to do it anyway. Because like, if they did it, say, in February or something and the Flames are out of the playoffs, you're not going to have a lot of enthusiasm on either side of the fence. So
yeah, and you never know what you're going to get. I mean, you know, we could have a great week around the time that we do it. We could have a terrible week around the time we do it if they did it during the preseason. And I think they've done one of these before at Winsport, but this one's at the Dome. So it's going to mean that much more to fans, to, you know, everybody to be there. So if you've got kids especially, might be worth checking out the Flames Red Rally, and that's on October 8th. That's this coming weekend on Saturday. So it should be fun. I think the first time they did an event like this, you and I went to, and that's when they unveiled the third jersey. And I was kind of disappointed by the event, but it sounds like overall this is going to be a better event. The Flames have also announced the return of the Super Skills competition. It's funny, because when you and I saw the first ads for the Red Rally, I said to you, Matt, they should put a skills competition in this. Do you remember me saying that?
Yeah.
So Saturday, December 3rd is going to be the skills competition, the first one they've done since 2012. It's $10 a ticket, and the Flames think that they'll be on sale by the end of the month. So, again, if you're looking for a fun thing to do, skills competitions are always fun. I personally like the skills competition idea. I think it's a great way to see kind of the players in a more lighthearted atmosphere, and usually they bring in some minor hockey players. I think last time I saw it in 2012, they had like minor hockey players competing against the Flames in some of the drills. So it's always interesting to root for, you know, the 10-year-old kid who's trying to shoot up more targets than a professional shooter. So two events there for the family, great things to go to. I may end up getting some tickets to the Super Skills competition. I think that'd be fun. Great early Christmas gift if you're looking for anybody on your list to buy Christmas gifts for. And that's going to be on Saturday, December 3rd, the day after we play Minnesota at home and right before we play Anaheim at home. So a tough weekend there for the Flames. Matt, I guess the last thing to discuss this week before we get to our predictions is the unveiling of the Oilers mascot. We have rivals to the north, and now Harvey has a rival to the north. They've unveiled Lynx, and his name is Hunter. And I don't know about you, this is the creepiest mascot I've ever seen.
Yeah, it's right up there. Yeah, it's Edmonton. You know, expecting them to do anything that makes sense in any way, shape, or form is a little bit too much. And like, this is supposed to be a fit, something for the kids, and so they made him the scariest looking thing that I think I've ever seen for a mascot.
He looks like something out of a horror movie, doesn't he?
Yeah, like that's more likely to give kids nightmares than anything.
Like, if you look at Harvey's fun, he's playful, he's got his tongue sticking out. There's no, I mean, I guess somebody could be afraid of Harvey, but Harvey's a fun character, and he's become part of not only the Flames, but the landscape in Southern Alberta. I don't know if you've ever been to charity events or family events around the city. Harvey's always there. You know, he's always doing things because people love him, and I don't think we're going to see anywhere near that reaction to Hunter, which is the Oilers' new mascot.
Yeah, he's more likely to give people nightmares than anything. So, like, even if you look around the league, like the other mascots, most of them are friendly looking, like Carlton in Toronto, the bear, polar bear thing they have. Or you can just go down the list. Like, they're all more upbeat for kids, not this fierce looking animal that's going to look like it's going to rip you to shreds. Like, it's not to motivate the players or something. Like, just,
well, this is also the team that has their own cheerleading squad too, remember?
True, but
yeah, I mean, most mascots are cute. You know, we have Bernie the Saint Bernard in Colorado. He's a cute looking dog. Finn the whale in Vancouver, who always looked very playful. Iceberg, which is the Pittsburgh Penguins mascot. Louie, the big teddy bear in St. Louis. Like, they're all fairly playful mascots. Even somebody like SJ Sharkey, the San Jose Sharks mascot, they've done a shark very well.
Yeah, to make it playful instead of, like, I'm going to rip your head off.
Yeah, I think Stinger, the old Blue Jackets mascot, was a little bit creepy. But, I mean, the Oilers one looks like something that they borrowed from a horror movie.
Exactly. And just really bad execution for what their market is. Like, it's not for adults, it's for kids.
Well, it really makes you wonder, I mean, who approved this, who okayed this? I think it's probably for the new arena, but I'll be interested to see how much we see this mascot. Like, Harvey's part of the games. We see him out there, he's banging his drum, he's drumming things up for the kids, the families, that sort of thing. I can't see Lynx doing much. And we've seen teams in the past that had scary mascots. Do you remember the Volk for the Hitmen?
No.
The Volk was this sort of Hulk-like mascot, big and muscular, and kids thought he was scary, so they replaced him with Freddy the Fox. So, I mean, if Edmonton wants terrible mascots, we could sell them the Volk. We could even sell them Scorch. There's a mascot they could use who's not as terrifying as this guy.
Yeah. I know. Like, just really bad execution.
This looks
on
like it would have fit well into the new Panthers logo.
Probably. Yeah, and you're right. That could have, you know, instead of making it a Lynx, you could have just made it a Panther and have it equally as fierce and all that.
I think, too, that the name Hunter doesn't really give you... I know it's named after former Oilers owner Wild Bill Hunter, but I don't know. The name Hunter doesn't give you that family-friendly vibe to it either.
No.
Like, Louie the Lynx or something makes sense. Like, Harvey the Hound, it's a fun name. It's sort of a silly name. But Hunter, it just sounds very aggressive right from the get-go.
Yeah. And then having it being so fierce looking, like it just, yeah.
And they got it wearing the stupid orange jersey.
Oh, of course. They got to make it a real class act.
So, yeah, I don't know. I don't see this lasting more than one season, and I don't see this lasting even the full season. I think you may see Hunter abandoned quite quickly. But if, you know, the Oilers are a terrifying team to watch, and now if you're in the stands, it'll be terrifying to watch their mascot as well. So I guess it all works together.
Yep. The team on the ice will give you nightmares, and so will their mascot. So there you go.
And maybe if they get desperate, they'll put the mascot on the ice. He might be able to play better defense than some of the guys they've signed.
Probably. Well, you saw the highlights of Griffin Reinhardt, so yeah. Not exactly skilled there.
But it'll be interesting to see if we see any sort of rivalry between him and Harvey. If you know, generally don't bring your mascot to away games, but I could see the others trying to drum some up there. But I don't know. To me, Harvey's one of he's the longest running NHL mascot for a reason. He's fun. He's playful. He fits with the team well. Everybody loves Harvey. I don't think you're going to find anyone who says, you know what, I really like Lynx. And Harvey sells a lot of merchandise too. I mean, if you go to the stores, they've got stuffies, they've got shirts. Nobody's going to buy it. Nobody wants a stuffed animal of this thing.
No.
Maybe I'll buy that for people I hate. Like, here, have this terrifying thing. Put it in your bed. You're not going to get nightmares. So, Matt, on a lighter note then, moving away from Edmonton, we got two games this week. The Flames have their final two exhibition games. On Wednesday the 5th, they have a home game where they host the Arizona Coyotes. And on the 6th, we have an away game where we'll be traveling to Vancouver against the Canucks. 4 points on the board. What do you think?
I'm going to go with the same prediction last week, win them all.
You think so?
Yeah, why not?
Do you think we'll get...
Be optimistic, you know?
You think we'll win both? I don't know. I think a lot of this, I think we're going to start to see a more opening day ready lineup pretty quick here. I think we're going to see a ton of cuts after each game. I think the Flames are going to split these. I think that we will lose to the Coyotes, and I think we'll win against the Canucks. And speaking of which, from last week, we had 10 points on the board because we had 5 games, and neither of us did all that well. You thought we'd win them all? You thought we'd get all 10 points that were available? I thought we'd get 4, but I thought we'd get them differently than we did. We got 4 points total. I thought we'd win at home against Edmonton, lose on the road against Edmonton, lose to Winnipeg, and win to Vancouver. So I got the right number of points. I just didn't get them in the right way. But you know what? It's preseason. We're still both getting back into doing our predictions. So we're not even going to...
Well, usually our predictions last year, we were wrong almost every time. So
I blame it on the goalies.
Yes. So it's not our fault for being wrong. It's the goalies' fault.
Well, they couldn't save a puck last year.
I know.
Games we should have won. So we're not even going to keep score on our results to date since it's preseason. But... I don't know. I hope you're right. I hope that we win them all. Last year, you tended to do better when you guessed that we'd lose them all. And I hope we don't have too many of those predictions this year.
Yeah. I don't like being a Debbie Downer.
No, but I mean, realistically, that's where we got to last year. Once we got past that self-denial phase,
yeah,
it started to become a realistic prediction. You know, at first you're like, oh, we're going to turn around. We're going to turn around. And eventually it's like, yeah, we're probably going to lose them all. Yeah, we'll probably lose these ones too. But, you know, it's what got us Tkachuk, so we can't complain too much.
No, and that's the one good thing. The Flames are adding pieces that will help them win a cup, hopefully in the near future. So whether it's Tkachuk helping out or even some of the other prospects that we pick up moving forward. So it's all good.
Well, we'll be back next week. That's it for this week, but we'll come back and we'll talk about the final two games of the preseason, and hopefully we'll be able to discuss opening day lineups. I think by the time we come back next week, we'll be pretty close to final rosters here. And based on what we talked about tonight, probably no surprises, but I think that we're really waiting on the Gaudreau deal to get signed before much else is done.
Yep, and then we'll be recapping the two Oilers games, or looking ahead to the two Oilers games and the Vancouver game next week. So
start of the season all against rivals. It'll be a good start.
Yep, get those games out of the way early.
Yeah, could be good or bad to get those out of the way early. If it's free wins over the Oilers, we might want to save those till later. We'll see.
Yeah, thanks for listening, everybody.
Have a good week, man.
Take it easy.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.